On the 15th of June, 1904, the General Slocum, a sidewheel passenger steamboat, set sail up the East River in New York. On board were around 1,300 passengers, mainly women and children who were taking part in a trip organized by the St. Mark's Evangelical Lutheran Church. Before reaching their destination, however, many of those on board would lose their lives in an accident that would remain the deadliest in New York history for almost 100 years. The General Slocum was built in 1891, the hull by Brooklyn boatbuilder Divine Burtis, and the upper works by Hoffmeyer and Son, also based in New York. She was a large ship at 80 meters or 264 feet in length, with 3 decks. The main deck was at the bottom of the ship, the promenade deck sat just above the main, and the hurricane deck, where the lifeboats were stored, was at the very top. Being a sidewheel boat, she had 2 large wheels with 26 paddles each, and a top speed of around 16 knots. She was owned by the Knickerbocker Steamship Company. The boat was named after an American hero, Henry Warner Slocum Sr. Slocum had been a Union general during the American Civil War. As one of the senior generals at the Battle of Gettysburg, he went on to become the elected representative at large for New York in the 48th Congress. His name was considered a byword for reliability and dignity, and therefore seen as the perfect name for a boat. Just 4 months after she was launched in 1891, the General Slocum suffered her first mishap when she ran aground off Rockaway, just south of New York City, and had to be pulled free by tugboats. Then, in 1894, there were multiple incidents. She struck a sandbar in July, ran aground off Coney Island in August, and collided with a tugboat in September, resulting in substantial damage to her steering. There were other incidents in the years that followed. Another collision in 1898, and she was even subject of an attempted mutiny in 1901, when transporting 900 drunk anarchists from New Jersey. On that day, a riot broke out which was eventually brought under control by the ship's crew. In 1902, she ran aground again, with passengers having to camp out overnight while they waited for the ship to be freed. By 1904, the ship's captain, William Van Schaik, was 62 years old and approaching retirement. The ship itself, once seen as glorious and modern, had been surpassed by faster, newer vessels in the waterways of New York. She was still making money for her owners, though. The St. Mark's Evangelical Lutheran Church had been using the General Slocum for 17 consecutive years for their annual picnic. The event was organized by Pastor George Haas to celebrate the end of the Sunday school year. He paid $350 for exclusive use of the General Slocum for the day. The picnic would take place on a Wednesday, when most men were working, and thus it would be attended mainly by Sunday school teachers, Sunday school pupils, and their mothers. Most of the church's congregation were drawn from an area known as Klein Deutschland, or Little Germany. It was called this because it had one of the largest German populations in the United States. On the morning of the 15th of June, 1904, the congregation met at the 3rd Street Pier in New York's Lower East Side. The passengers were all dressed in their finest clothes as they boarded the ship. A band was playing on the promenade deck. Flags were waving and all 3 levels of the boat were packed with 1,300 passengers and a total of 30 officers and crew. At around 9:30 a.m., the boat left 3rd Street and proceeded up the East River. By around 10 a.m., she had made her way up towards the narrow passage of Hell Gate, between Ward's Island and Queens. On board, all was well. Passengers were taking in the view or enjoying the food and beverages that had been laid on for the trip. Chowder for adults, and milk for the children. It was at this point that a small fire started in a forward cabin known as the Lamp Room, which was the 3rd compartment from the bow under the main deck. The original cause of the fire was never discovered, but it is considered likely that it was caused by a discarded cigarette or match. The lamp room was not only where the ship's lamps were stored, but also where they were refilled from large barrels of oil. Oily rags lay scattered about the room, along with a significant amount of packing straw for drinking glasses that had been brought on board by the church group. As a government report later put it, This forward cabin was in an excessively unsafe condition as regards fire. When a crew member saw smoke and went to investigate, they immediately called for the fire hose. The hose was fetched, but much to their dismay, it was rotten and leaking, meaning that very little water could be conveyed to the site of the fire. Another crew member tried to use a different hose, but couldn't connect it to the water supply. As the crew attempted to smother the fire with sacks and coats, passengers saw smoke and flames and began to mill around the deck, creating a great deal of confusion, even panic. At this point, Captain Van Schaik was unaware of the fire. A 12-year-old boy had tried to notify him, but the captain simply did not believe him. It was a full 10 minutes after the fire was first discovered that he was officially notified, and his response was to order full steam ahead, staying on course. He would later state that he was wary of grounding the burning ship, as he had noticed oil storage tanks on the nearby shore. Mere minutes later, though, he changed his mind and ordered the boat to be beached on North Brother Island. Captain Van Schaik then went to the hurricane deck, where he remained until he was forced to jump overboard into shallow water. By this time, the crew had given up trying to extinguish the flames. They instead turned to the lifeboats on the hurricane deck, but found that they were wired in place with some wires painted over, making them impossible to unfasten. Passengers desperately sought ways to escape the boat. Many seized life preservers, only to find that these were woefully inadequate. The ancient belts had perished over time, with some falling apart in the hands of the passengers. The cork which filled others had broken down to dust inside, dust which, instead of floating, readily absorbed water. Desperate mothers put life jackets on their children and threw them overboard, only to watch in horror as they sank rather than floated. It was very rare for Americans to be able to swim at the time, and the clothes that they were wearing were made from heavy wool, making swimming to safety almost impossible. The Chicago Tribune described the scene. It was a spectacle of horror beyond words to express. A great vessel all in flames, sweeping forward in the sunlight, within sight of the crowded city, while her helpless, screaming hundreds were roasted alive or swallowed up in the waves. By the time the ship had run aground on North Brother Island, she had been completely engulfed by fire. It had been just 20 minutes since flames were discovered. The island was home to a quarantine hospital, so doctors and nurses were on hand to treat the injured, while two tugboats and several smaller vessels assisted those in the water. These small boats may have been responsible for saving as many as 350 lives. Unfortunately, help came too late for the majority of the passengers on board. In total, according to a government report, 957 people, including two members of the crew, died, either burned to death or drowned. Only 431 people survived. Captain Van Schaik lost an eye in the disaster, but survived. With this one disaster, the community of Little Germany was devastated. Around 600 families experienced at least one loss, and the Lower East Side became clogged with funeral carriages for weeks. There was outrage in the wider community, as New Yorkers demanded answers. As newspapers published reports of the accident, the anger grew. Eventually, President Roosevelt was compelled to form a commission to investigate the disaster. The findings were bleak. No effort had been made to maintain the safety equipment on the ship. The hoses were made of cheap linen, which was said to cost probably less than 20 cents a foot. The hoses were twisted and kinked, with multiple leaks. The crew had not practiced a fire drill that year, and the lifeboats were inaccessible in an emergency. The life preservers, branded Kahnweiler's Never Sink Life Preservers, had been stowed on the ship, unmaintained, for 13 years, causing them to rot. Not only that, but it was also discovered that the manufacturer, Nonpareil Corkworks, had filled out some life jackets with small iron bars in order to save money on cork filling, while still producing jackets that appeared to be the correct weight. Ultimately, the responsibility for the safety of the passengers fell on Captain Van Schaick. While the wisdom of his action on the day of the disaster was debated at length, nobody could argue that he had kept the safety equipment on board the General Slocum in acceptable condition. He was found guilty of criminal negligence for failing to maintain proper fire drills and fire extinguishers, and sentenced to 10 years imprisonment. He served 3 years before he was pardoned by President Taft. The owners of the General Slocum, the Knickerbocker Steamship Company, were given a small fine, despite evidence that they falsified inspection records. Life Preserver Manufacturers Nonpareil Corkworks were indicted but not convicted. Despite the horrific scale of the General Slocum disaster, it was somewhat lost to history, as it was overshadowed by the sinking of the Titanic in 1912. On the subject of why this might be, Adela Wotherspoon, one of the survivors from the General Slocum, later suggested, "The Titanic had a great many famous people on it. This was just a family picnic."